No matter what time of day we dropped by, my grandmother, Sitti, would take everything out of the refrigerator, whatever she had, and put it on the table, say, eat. A saucer of olives, a last piece of rhubarb pie, a jar of pickled turnips, a plate of kibbeh, warm Lebanese bread, spinach pies. Her kitchen had a distinct blend of scents, cinnamon, coffee, tobacco, whiskey. I'd sit at the table in Sitti's kitchen and let the adult gossip murmur into the background while I attended to the windows. In dark evenings, if the lights were off in the house next door, the windows bounced reflections at us like mirrors, like magic, and I'd watch my grandpa, doubled in the window's reflection, scoop his customary 3 heaping sugar spoonfuls into his cup of black coffee and stir. When the neighbor's lights were on, I could see directly into their kitchen. I loved it when the neighbor's lights were on, for it meant warmth. It meant sharing. When I was in Sitti's kitchen, I ate Lebanese food as I watched the neighbors pass deep Vietnamese bowls of noodles and foods I couldn't identify but wanted to taste. I used the flatbread as my utensil to scoop rice from stuffed tripe and catch the juices of cinnamon, black pepper, garlic, mint, and lemon. I watched the neighbor's chopsticks click soundlessly behind the silence of the windows. I imagined my body laying across the sills to bridge the short space between the houses, my body's short length bridging our 2 families, our 2 homes, our 2 meals, our 2 Asias, connecting my family Southwest Asia to their family Southeast Asia in that short reach between our 2 sills. After dinner, in the summertime, when the days were long and light, I'd go outside and linger on the front steps with Grandpa and Dad. I'd skip on the sidewalk, I'd jump on the cracks, until finally, Chung would come running out her front door, followed by her sisters Ha and Lee, Tree and Hung. Sometimes their parents would stand on the steps, and by then, Mom and Sitti were outside too, and everybody would wave, hello, hi, hello, free now to acknowledge one another, no windows between us, and move toward each other to stand coalesced in that small yard space that bridged the 2 homes. Meanwhile, Chung and her sisters and I would play clapping games until dark, and we skipped and hopped and raced up and down the sidewalk. Sometimes my cousins were there too, and we all made up games to play outside the 2 homes. Standing together in a circle on the sidewalk, our hands articulated the intricate conversation of clapping games. There we stood in our clapping circle, our dancing hands pairing unpaired palms in a synchronized frenzy. My cousin Angie and I laughing with our Lebanese eyes framed by our dark brown and very thick, curly, rough, unruly hair. Chung and her sisters laughing with their Vietnamese eyes framed by their shiny, black, sleek, straight, smooth, long, fine hair. We never marveled at the differences because we recognized each other in our laughter and in the touch of our hands. One time, after dark, we all went inside and piled around Sitti's kitchen table where the adult women were talking. My aunts and my mother were all sisters-in-law of various ethnicities, Lebanese, Mexican, Italian, Irish, each married to Eunice brothers. Chung's mother was telling her story, mixing her mother tongue with English, speaking fast, sometimes haltingly, with tears. I heard boat. I heard flea, and I saw her eyes were wet. The brown mole on the eyelash line of her right eye punctuated her solemn intensity. Her large, round cheekbones were wide set and high, with skin stretched thin and tight, mapping the terrain of her journey. She fled to America with her husband, clutching 5 daughters and a fierce fistful of hope. Mom's and my aunt's eyes were locked on her eyes and their brows were creased. Their heads wagged slow and nodded deep. They clicked their tongues in empathy, leaned in from their hearts, murmuring, how hard, how strong. Their hands reached for her hands and she unclenched her fists. Geographies of extended arms and open palms bridged skin tones, embraced, entwined ancestries. I saw them, doubled in the window's reflection. I see them now, in reflection, how they recognized each other in their power, in solidarity and survival, in the touch of their hands. A web of kinship spanning continents, circled and centered on the kitchen table where food and stories and generations embodied and transmitted through tongues and palms and fingertips, nourished interconnection and created feelings of belonging in Sitti's kitchen on Arago Street.